Everyone, let's move to our next topic in open channel flow, which is rapidly varied flow. And in this, mainly we have to focus on hydraulic jump, which is a very important topic. And so what is rapidly varied flow? As we saw earlier also, if the depth of flow is changing in a very short length, that means if the depth of flow, change in depth of flow is sudden, so then it is a case of rapidly varied flow. In this case also, it is a steady non-uniform flow as it was in the gradually varied flow. But here the depth will be increasing in a very short length, in a few meters. Whereas in gradually varied flow, this distance was in kilometers. So the depth of flow changes in a very short distance. That's why it is termed as rapidly varied flow. And in this case, streamlines will be having a large curvature, and in the zone where rapidly varied flow is forming, we cannot assume the pressure to be hydrostatic. But to simplify the calculation, before the rapidly varied flow and after the rapidly varied flow, as we will see in the case of hydraulic jump, which is the only major topic in this unit, we will study how we apply the pressure distribution. And so hydraulic jump is the best example for rapidly varied flow. My mistake. So let's move to hydraulic jump. So it occurs when flow condition changes from supercritical to subcritical, which results in an abrupt increase. So let's say there is a channel and water is coming at very high velocity in supercritical flow condition. And in the downstream, there is a large, comparatively large depth, and it is moving here in a subcritical flow condition. So when this water will meet the subcritical flow water, so it will try to achieve the height of the subcritical flow condition. And in achieving this height, there will be eddies will be forming, and this will be a turbulent flow scenario. So in this condition, the wave which forms here, we call it as standing wave, or in other words we call as hydraulic jump. Here also it is written that if the shallow stream of water with supercritical velocity strikes water having a large depth of flow, that's just similar what I have explained, then the hydraulic jump will form. And so there are few examples, typical examples where the hydraulic jump forms. So let's say this is the channel bed, and here it is a sluice gate. And if the water will be at a high level on the upstream, and if we want to release some water, if we are just opening a very little of this gate, then what will happen here, the flow may, because of this small area and large flow, this may be converted into a supercritical condition. And if the slope is small, then here it will again try to obtain its subcritical flow height. Maybe we are putting some obstruction here, so because of that, it will try to attain this subcritical flow height, and in attaining that, there will be a very large eddies will form, which we name as hydraulic jump. And other example is bottom of the spillway, that is downstream of spillway. So what happens here? If we have a very high structure, if we have a very big dam, and so the spillway height will also be very high, and because of that, if we release the water from very big height, so from here the water will be having a lot of energy, and if we release this water with high energy in the water, it will erode the channel bed. So whatever river is there, it will be eroded and scouring will take place, which we don't want. And so here what we will do to release this energy, we will put some obstruction, and so because of that, we'll increase the tail water height. And so if we are increasing this height, So the whatever flow is coming from here at high speed, it will try to attain this another height, which is the subcritical flow condition. And in this subcritical flow, the water can flow easily without causing any destruction to the downstream flow and banks. So it is necessary to release some energy here so we can save our downstream structures. So there are few applications, one of which I have just explained as an energy dissipator. So what I said is, if the structure is having the water is having very high energy due to the height of the structure, so we want to dissipate some of this energy. So we want to make sure the hydraulic jump forms here so we can dissipate some energy here. And to mix the chemicals in a water purification system, because here a lot of turbulence is being created. As we saw, it is associated with a high turbulence and eddy, so we can mix any chemical very easily, so it will be mixed properly, and so we can use it in the water treatment process also to aerate the polluted stream. So this, due to this turbulence and all, there will be a large air entrainment, so air will also enter in this flow, and because of that, if air is entering, it means that oxygen is being supplied to the water, so we can aerate the polluted stream, and that will help to reduce the pollution and to increase the weight of an apron and hence reducing the uplift pressure. So let's say there is a some structure like this, and on the upstream of its water level is till here, and if we release from here, if we release the water at this height, it will be having a very large velocity and very low depth. And what is the case here, whatever soil is below this, due to this head difference, the water will seep through the soil below the structure, and this seepage pressure will be very high at this point. If this delta H very high, delta H is very high, so this seepage pressure will also be very high. So to make sure that uplift pressure is reduced, what we can do, if the water height is more here, so this will, because of this water, there will be a bigger weight on this part of the apron, and so the uplift pressure will be nullified. And so because of that, we can here again put some obstruction, so the hydraulic jump forms in this area, and so the energy is released. Let's move to the momentum equation and specific force. So what happens here, as I said, it in this case we cannot apply the specific energy. Because when the jump is forming in this zone, energy loss is taking place, and this energy loss we don't know. This is an internal energy loss, so we cannot quantify this value. So because of that, we choose to apply the momentum equation, which only deals with the external forces. So it will cover the pressure and velocity and momentum. So those things we can easily know in this case. So as I discussed earlier in the introductory lecture, again we can see if some jump is forming here, and so let's take this section between these two. If some weight will be applied here, then weight of component in the direction of flow will be W sine theta, and Fw is the friction, boundary friction force. So if I apply the momentum equation, it will be equal to, here some pressure force will be there, and here it will be V2. So net external forces will be P1 minus P2 plus W sine theta minus Ff, and it will be equal to the change in momentum. So, because this length is very small, we can neglect some of the things. We can exactly neglect the boundary friction because in a very small length, this value will be very small, and because of that fact, we can neglect it. And if this bed is almost horizontal and or it may be having a very little slope, and in that case, theta will be nearly equal to zero, or it will be having a very small value, and sine theta will be approximately equal to zero. So these two forces are not coming into picture, and we'll be having P1 plus M1 by gamma, as we can write P2 plus M2 gamma. This is again the equation of specific force as we saw earlier also. This term is having the dimension of force, so we denote it as specific force. Now we can generalize it for any channel. Let's say the channel cross section is something like this, and from here the distance of centroid is y bar. And so P1, as we know, in the we because before and after the jump, the condition of flow we are assuming as the pressure distribution we are assuming as again as hydrostatic, because there is no turbulence before and after the jump. This is how we are taking it. So if I take the pressure distribution as hydrostatic, so for an average depth of y bar, the pressure I can write as gamma into y bar. This is per unit area, and let's say if the area is A, so this pressure will be gamma A y, and momentum I can write as rho q v. And if I put this value here, P, if I say P is equal to gamma A y, so gamma A y bar plus rho q v gamma, so it is equal to A y plus v. I can write as q by a, so rho q square by a gamma, and so this we can say a y plus q square upon g a, because gamma is equal to rho g. And so this is a constant value of specific force, and using this equation we can find out the hydraulic pre-jump depth and post-jump depth using this equation. So let's do the analysis for a rectangular channel. This is having a bed width of V and depth of flow y. So the location of centroid will be, let's say, y bar, which will be equal to y by 2 in case of rectangular channel. So if I apply this same equation here, ay plus q square y ga constant. Now y bar is equal to y by 2, and a is equal to by into y by 2 plus q square upon g by equal to constant. Now if I divide it by b, it will be y square upon 2 plus q square upon g b square y. This is also a constant because the width is remaining constant. From here, y square by 2 plus this will be small q square g y equal to constant. Now we can use this equation and apply to our pre-jump depth and post-jump depth. Right? If this is the jump and here the depth is y1 and after it is y2, so because the specific force is remaining same, so we can use this equation for section 1 and section 2. So this is 1 and this is 2. So I can write it as y1 square upon 2 plus q square upon g y1 is equal to y2 square upon 2 plus q square upon g y2. And rearranging this, 1 by 2 y1 square minus y2 square is equal to q square upon g 1 upon y2 minus 1 upon y1. And from here, if we solve it further, this will be y1 minus y2 y2 y1 plus y2 is equal to q square upon g y1 minus y2 upon y1 y2. You can cancel this. So y1 y2 y1 plus y2 is equal to 2q square upon g. This is also a very important relationship, and it comes handy when we are solving numericals. Now from the Frau number formula, we know f is equal to v upon under root g y, and for a particular section f1, if I say it is equal to v1 upon under root g y, which is again equal to q upon v y under root g y, and for if I am writing for section, this will be y1 here also y1. And f1 square is equal to q by v, I can write as small q, so q square upon, if I'm doing the square, so this will be equal to g y1 cube. And similarly for f2 also, we can say f2 square is equal to q square upon g y2 cube. And from here, if I use the value of q square upon g from here, this is equal to f1 square into y1 cube, and if I put this value in this equation, so y1 y2 y1 plus y2 is equal to 2f1 square y1 cube, and if we divide this y1 cube on this side, so it will be y1 square y2 plus y1 y2 square divided by y1 cube to f1 square. So this will be y2 by y1 plus y2 by y1 whole square. I can write minus 2f1 square is equal to 0. So this is a quadratic equation in y2 by y1. And if we solve this quadratic equation, we will get the solution as y2 by y1 is equal to, we can use the formula, minus b plus under root of b square minus 4ac upon 2a. So minus b is 1 here, plus minus under root of b square, again 1 square minus 4 into a into c. 4, a is 1 and c is minus 2f1 square upon 2 to 1. So y2 by y1 is equal to minus 1 plus minus root of 1 plus 8 f1 square upon 2. Now we can discard the minus sign, because if we use the minus sign, this whole term will be negative and the depth cannot be negative. So this will be equal to minus 1 plus under root of 1 plus 8 f1 square upon 2. This is the formula for rectangular channel. Similarly, we can write in term of f2 also. In that case, it will be y1 upon y2 and 1 plus minus 1 plus under root of 1 plus 8f2 square divided by 2. Now we defined a specific force here as F is equal to, this is our next topic, which is secant F then specific force. So specific force we saw earlier also, it is Q square by GA plus AY. And if we can write this as for a rectangular channel, we can write as Q square by GBY plus A. B into y into y upon 2. And if we plot the value of specific force with respect to depth, because only depth is varying in this formula, so we get the specific force diagram like this. This is similar to specific energy diagram only, but it is different than that because specific energy is not same in this case. So the here also we can say, if this is the specific force on this axis and this is the depth, and so for any specific force we are getting two depth of flow, and for a particular value we are getting two depth of flow, and these two depths are called as secant depth. And so here y1 and a pre-jump depth and post-jump depth, these are for the same specific force and are called as secant depth or conjugate depth. It is not called as alternate depth because alternate depth we are associating with the same specific energy. In this case, specific energy will not be the same because head loss is taking place. So if I make the specific energy diagram, so what is happening here, if at section 1 this is the specific energy, and so when it is reaching at, let's say this is the supercritical depth y1, and so when it is reaching the subcritical condition it should reach this depth, but it is not the case. If here the energy is E1, some energy loss will be taking place, and after that the energy will be reduced to some value E2. And so for this E2 there will be this depth y2. So these two are the secant depths, but this head loss we cannot quantify this head loss very properly if we use this specific energy equation. That's why we opt for this specific energy diagram. And here these two depths are known as secant of conjugate depth. And for the minimum specific force, here we can see it is the minimum specific force, it is associated with a single depth. So this is again equal to the critical depth of flow. So from here also, if we differentiate this equation, F is equal to Q square by G BY, so BY square upon 2. If we find out DF upon DY for minimum specific force, here also we get the condition Q square T by GA cube is equal to 1, which defines the critical flow condition. So this I told earlier also. So for a given discharge, given Q specific force is minimum at critical depth. So as I said, there energy loss also takes place, so we can find out the energy loss also using the total energy difference between section 1 and section 2, and using the equation which we got from our मोमेंटम एनालिसिस. सो एनर्जी लॉस इफ आई राइट ई एल इज इक्वल टू टोटल एनर्जी एट सेक्शन वन, टोटल एनर्जी एट सेक्शन टू, बिकॉज दिस इज अ हॉरिजॉन्टल बेड. सो टोटल एनर्जी एट सेक्शन वन विल बी इक्वल टू वाई वन प्लस वी स्क्वायर अपॉन टू जी, वी वन स्क्वायर अपॉन टू जी माइनस वाई टू प्लस वी टू स्क्वायर अपॉन टू जी. दिस कैन बी रिटन एज वाई वन माइनस वाई टू प्लस वी आई कैन राइट इन द टर्म्स ऑफ स्मॉल क्यू ऑल्सो. सो दिस विल बी इक्वल टू फॉर द सेम डिस्चार्ज इफ आई राइट इट इज इक्वल टू क्यू स्क्वायर अपॉन टू जी वाई वन स्क्वायर माइनस क्यू स्क्वायर अपॉन टू जी वाई टू स्क्वायर. So if for this is equation 1 and another equation that we know is y1 plus y2 into y1 y2 is equal to 2q square upon g. If I put the value of q square upon g in this equation from this equation, so finally I can get the energy loss is equal to y2 minus y1 whole cube divided by 4 y1 y2. This is the final equation which we use to calculate the energy loss. Of course only in a rectangular channel. If it is a different channel then this formula cannot be used. So there are some types of jump depending upon the incoming Froude number, or you can say the Froude number of the incoming flow. And so if the Froude number is between 1 and 1.7, this is still 1.7, so it is known as undular jump. In this case the depth variation will not be very much and the jump will not be very clear. This will be something like this. And this is undular jump. Next is weak jump. So this is for the Froude number between 1.7 to less than equal to 2.5. So here there is as we keep on increasing the Froude number, so this depth will increase and the difference in height, that means y2 minus y1, this will be increasing. And if it is increasing then the energy loss which is given as y2 minus y1 whole cube and 4y1 y2, so this will also increase. So if we want to dissipate more energy, then this should be more, this difference should be more. So it will be something like this for this weak jump. Then oscillating jump. In oscillating jump, this here oscillations will be, I mean the water will flow in some random manner, and after that the next is steady jump. This is a well established jump and proper rollers will form in this case. There will be rollers here, and after that there will be strong jump. And so for strong, this depth will be very small in that case. And here this undulations will go for a large distance in the downstream in the case of strong jump. So we need to remember this Froude numbers in between all these jumps. So this is 2.5 to 4.5 for oscillating jump and 4.5 to 9 for steady jump, greater than 9 for strong jump. And for length of jump, which is given as the distance between these two parts where the jump starts and till the point where it meets the downstream water level, this we define as length of jump. And so from experiments it is found out almost equal to 6.9 or 7 y two minus y one. So that's it in this unit. We'll do some examples for this also. Thank you.